Yeah, okay, good. Okay, I'll start with microphone. So, so this is the last session of the day. It's probably the least teaching, the least amount of teaching content. It's about projects, the Krishna Murti Foundation, and I hope you find yourself in the right place. Javier Gomez is not showing up here. He's in the other space. Just to tell you. just a little bit of a summary that everybody has an overview of what we're doing. And we start what we have been doing with the foundation over the last 50 years. And also what we're doing currently. And what we do in the future. And part of that also, at a certain point, we will go into, I will ask some members here of the other foundation around, and we'll ask them to also to say a few things about the international foundations, how the foundations work together, and also differences between the foundations. We can, each foundation is somehow uniquely different and has their own emphasis. And so it's good to bring that out. Current and future projects. And I'll not be only speaking, I'm also going to ask Corey to supplement me. And I have a microphone here for Corey. I don't know what happened to the microphone, or it's going to come. Yeah, maybe we can keep it in your hand, Corey. Yeah. Good. So, and Corey is the director of publications and the director of the archive. So you can see him from the back, and that's good. Okay, so the Krishnamurti Foundation, the KFA, you have to imagine there are roughly about three parts to it. There's a foundation part, which includes the archives, includes publications, it includes the web and social media. It includes also, which I haven't mentioned here, but it also includes things like fundraising. And attached to that, there's a whole admin part related to that. So that's the foundation part. Then you have the Krishnamurti Educational Center, which we normally summarize as the center, which has a retreat and the location of it. We're currently at the school campus, which is on one side of Ojai, but there's the KAC campus is on the other side of Ojai. It's about 15 minutes in between. And there we have a retreat. We have a center, and the center is the former house of Krishnamurti, Pine Cottage, and land. And the land, the campus land. And then finally, there's the school, and I will say a little about the school because Jody, in other presentations and other tours, has said already lots about the school. So I will leave that topic out. So the first thing is maybe to say is because if you look at the foundation, the mission of the foundation is to disseminate Krishnamurti's work and preserve Krishnamurti's work. Now, and because the emphasis of dissemination is so strongly on internet now and social media, I want to start there because that's like a critical piece. It doesn't mean that this is more important than the other areas. We're still doing a lot with publishing and other things. But for those who know, there is an international website, JKO, and that has all the teachings. It's like a library with all the content, and you can, if you want to find a transcript or a video, it's a perfect place to find there, to look there and to find some content. Also very strongly, one of the stronger social medias that the foundations internationally are running is the YouTube channel, and that's all the videos that we have currently available are available there, or are going to be available there, and most of the audios are available there. I think there are currently about 1,200 different items on that YouTube. But we found that the nor YouTube nor JKO, the International Teachings website, are good places for new people to start if you are interested in exploring. because a new person might not know much about Krishnamurti, might know nothing about Krishnamurti, but might be interested in the kind of issues that Krishnamurti addresses. Now, and if so, we wanted to make it easy that if you're completely new, you somehow your interest has been triggered, you somehow are interested in the, to find another way of somehow being able to skim through the teachings, but have the possibility of going down and going all the way deeper down. So what we've done is, what you see here is a bit of a paragraph, and we're emphasizing a quote. So now that's an important thing that we try to do. So we want to skim on the surface, but we want to remain the keep the context of the whole text. Because for those who have seen quotes, if you take a quote of Krishnamurti out of context, it easily starts to mean something else. So what we said, okay, we want to maintain context, but we want to also emphasize quotes. So this is how we solved it, by showing part of the context and the quote itself. Then to add to that, if you this app, and this app is in development, and we hope to launch that in a few months, if you click on this, you can immediately click to the full video, or the full transcript is there. The audio, if it's there, you can like it, you can get information, or you can share it. And if you with this app, if you flip right to left, you see more of the same topic. So if this is love, then you flip through it, you see more on love. If you go up and down, you see different topics. So you can just browse to different topics. And we have so far about 1,500 different topics. And in collecting these topics is also really important, is that you somehow have to imagine that when people who are very familiar with Krishnamurti, who select keywords of Krishnamurti, often select keywords that they are familiar with, because Krishnamurti has certain keywords that he uses: awakening of intelligence, freedom from the known, observer is the observed. Now that helps for people who know Krishnamurti, but somebody who doesn't know Krishnamurti is not helped by that. So somehow actually, so what we've done and is actually, we use keyword extraction software, and a volunteer who is here in the room has helped me with that, great way. So keyword so there's actually, it's not being looked at from the content of somebody who already knows the material, and because somebody who knows the material is already selecting in a certain particular way. And we want to somehow select keywords that are non-specific, as general as possible. So so the keywords, so you can go click on it, then you are in the transcript exactly at the location. So if you click on it, in the transcript exactly on the location where the, in the transcript where this quote is from. If you click on video, you land in the video exactly at the location of the video where that video starts. So that is the idea. So you are able to browse on the servers, and you can click, and then you can go all the way down to the audio or the video or the transcript. So you maintain context. So I feel that is the winning point. And it's in development, and there are many hiccups, but I feel we're probably going to achieve this in the end. Does it sound reasonable and logical and sane?
How do I get to this?
At the moment, you can't, because it's being developed. But as soon as it's developed, and if you're on our e-newsletter, you will see it. We will announce it. Maybe 2 months. Yeah, I think in the summer we will have it going. Yeah. Also, another addition with what we found is that, of course, with social media, you can comment on quotes and you can like quotes, which is very important, because a quote that's more liked shows that there's some resonance with people who are reading it. So the liked thing and the comment thing is very important. And comment is, of course, some form of, hey, I like this quote, or hey, this reminds me of what somebody else said, so that's common. But we build in, we use a facility that's from another app in this, which creates the possibility of, in a scholarly way, go through the transcript. So that will mean that you can actually annotate and put comments to it, and I even relate different parts of the text to other parts of text. And you can share it with more than one person. So there's an annotation plugin to this that will help you to do more scholarly research on Krishnamurti. I don't know about you, but I have gone through so much Krishnamurti's text, but I have never kept track of it. I have notes, I have a drawer full of notes, but I wish I had started annotating right from the beginning. Because sometimes, you know, you have this quote, I mean, where did I see it? And it's lost, of course, because you have to go back and spend a lot of time, and searching is not always that easy. So the annotation will help creating more scholarship for the individual, but also scholarship for groups of people. Yeah, so that's the app. So it's a new way to navigate. So that will be the next thing, and we hope it's going to be a success. And we start with about 744 transcripts and about 400 videos, and then we will expand. And it will link, the videos are linked to the YouTube. So in an indirect way, you go to the existing international YouTube page, which is managed by the Krishnamurti Foundation in England. So, okay, good, eh? We can do questions afterward. Now, the other one is initiative that we have, an online, again, online, through a mobile phone and through YouTube. So what we found is that many, if you want to get interest from younger generations, people from 18 or 17 up to, say, 30, then planting them in front of a 1.5 hour Krishnamurti tape, it does not work all the time. It sometimes works, but it doesn't work all the time. And what I've noticed that if you have smaller clips with some of the text of Krishnamurti and sometimes different footage on top of it, it resonates. Younger people start to look at it, start watching it, start liking it. And this is a whole channel, the immeasurable.org that we built. It's like an online magazine where you can, this is a video. It's a transcript, a fragment of a transcript of Krishnamurti with different footage on it. There are essays in it from different people. And I definitely recommend it. And this immeasurable will also be then directly linked to the portal. So when you start, come across Krishnamurti through the immeasurable, which we actively promote through the online social media, you can go to, it will link to the portal. So, and maybe interesting, because what our hope was that we would see new and younger audiences, and also more females. If you look at the statistics online, so who is browsing through Krishnamurti, it's often, number one is maybe United States, number two is India, and number three is maybe Europe, or maybe even Argentina. It's like a very funny, it changes a bit, but it's very funny how that the hits are on the internet. But mostly male, and mostly a little bit older. Now with this, we want to reach a younger generation, but also enough females. And it has worked. We've looked at the statistics. There's clearly in the gap between 18 and about 24, and you see a much bigger participation, a majority participation, and it's more balanced in male and female. So as far as our what we set out to do, we've been able to manage that. So, and this is available for everybody. If you receive our e-newsletter, you will receive listings of this. So, I'm going to ask Corey to say something. You can stand up or you can sit, whatever you want. Yeah. So maybe I can preamble it before Corey starts. So, and I said this already in the beginning, in the start of today. The collected works is maybe the main presentation that we, the foundation, the KFA, has published. It was published in early 70s and came out and covers from 1933 to 1968. It's a massive collection of text. And it's like the, I don't know, the the hallmark presentation. That's a name for it. The key product that we published. That's maybe a bit of history.
Wait, I don't need this. I guess if I can just stand here, I'm a little shorter. Hi. I'll speak a little bit about the collected works, but then in general, more broadly about books, unless they're okay. With the collected works, we have now released a hardcover edition, and so that's available now for the first time on our bookstore and will be available at the library next week. And we also have a company in England that is now managing all of our ebooks and digital publications, including audio streaming on Spotify, and hopefully in the future, audio books on Audible and things like that. So he's worked with us to give us the opportunity to put ebooks directly onto our bookstore, so you can now purchase and download ebooks directly from the Krishnamurti bookstore without having to go through Amazon or somewhere else. So that's just, we're hoping to expand that to other books, but for now, that's specifically with the collected works. So we now have all three editions or types of the versions of the book available on our bookstore, which is great. So, then if you want to go to the, I'll just keep going with books. So I'm not going to mention too much about this first one, Unconditionally Free, just very briefly that it's there's a project that's sort of a side project that Michael Mendisa has been working with Evelyn Blau, who was the creator of the exhibit that's behind you. And this book, Unconditionally Free, is going to be an expanded edition of the exhibit in a book form. So I don't know, have too many details about the date of when we expect that to be available, but that's currently in works. There's a book, if you've been to the library, you've probably seen it. It's a beautiful photographic book put together by a friend of Krishnamurti's that was around for many years and took many beautiful photos. We are having it reprinted currently, so hopefully within the next couple of months we'll have that available again. It's a really nice like hardcover with photos from, I don't know, three or four primary locations that Krishnamurti spent a lot of his life. So the Asit Chanmol was the name of the photographer responsible for this book, and he passed away maybe a couple weeks ago, really. Yeah, so we're going to make sure to honor him in the book in the new edition, and So the foundation in England has been working with Watkins Publishing, which is sort of a well-established and older publisher in England that will be releasing the new Krishnamurti book for this year in August. So this is previously unpublished material, and this is the book of the year, basically, that the foundations are releasing. So I think it may even be available for pre-order on Amazon, but it's available or being shipped in August. So this is just moving forward. One of the projects at the KFA is to update and redesign the study books. There's a collection of study books and then quite a few of the old HarperCollins theme books, like On Living and Learning, On Meditation, On God. Many of those books are no longer in print, so we're going to be redesigning and re-releasing them, and hopefully working on having them work in conjunction with the development of online courses. So we'll have online courses that we'll be developing that will coincide with these theme books. So our hope is that they become another sort of collectible edition of the teachings, similar to the collected works, but more thematically based. So that's sort of a future project in book land. Yeah, so I can switch to archives. So the like publications, the archive in general is a very international coordinated mission of the foundation. One of the primary pieces of the archive or work of the archive at the KFA is the maintenance of the digital server. So the server that holds all of the digital archives originals and the server that all of the archivists around the world are working on a daily basis is housed in the archive at the KFA. So we manage that and maintain the security of that. So that's a large portion of my role as the archivist, is the sort of the daily maintenance and backing up. So to give you an idea, we have the server here with all of the originals. We have a complete copy of all of the originals on the same server, plus a copy of it on external drives, and two other copies at the foundation in England, as well as other external drives with other copies. So we have like layers of redundancy on many layers, which is necessary with digital information. And that requires actually a pretty consistent maintenance in terms of security. So, but I think in general, we've worked over the past year to bring the level from the generator that maintains power to the server, the kinds of security with a firewall, the access that the people that work on the server around the world have, has really all been upgraded and checked. And so I think we're kind of at a new level of security and maintenance in general with the server. So it makes me better sleep at night. And and in general, it's just good for the preservation of information. So yeah, I mean, it's a consistent work. We're already, you know, this server, we have a brand new server as of 2 years ago, but the lifespan of a server is about 7 years. So we already have to start planning on the next iteration of the server. So it's a continuous process, maintaining a digital collection. One thing that's really exciting, we applied for and were awarded a grant, in a program called California Revealed, which is a program that's run by the California State Library. So there's a collection of four talks that Krishnamurti gave in 1970 in Santa Monica, as well as San Diego, that have not been completely digitized before. And since we were awarded this, the footage is going to be digitized in 2K, so we'll have higher resolution footage than we've ever had before, and it's being done for free. And it will also be included in a collection, a broader collection of California historical materials available to the public for free. So it's just another way that people will be able to stumble upon Krishnamurti's work, having not had any prior knowledge of it, and a way for us to get high quality work done, digitization work done. And they're going to be cleaning and restoring and rehousing the films for us. And so it's been a great opportunity. So we're all excited to get that back. And then in general, we have a bunch of other just preservational projects going on. I think in the background, one of our primary missions now is to look at really long-term preservational media, particularly media that's technologically independent. So using images that are printed very small that only need magnification and not some technological intervention to read the information. So it's that kind of thing we're looking into for materials that will store and hold the information for, you know, 500, 700 years, 1,000 years, to try and sort of long-term preservation goals, sort of a background project that I find interesting that we're looking into at the KFA. That might be it for publication. Okay.
Yeah, and also important is that the work that has been happening over the last 8 years on the KC campus, you have to, not everybody realizes that actually the KC campus, that many of the buildings are built by renowned architects, known architects, and that the buildings were in a bad state when we started working. As you maybe know, Pine Cottage, Krishna Muti lived there, and afterwards Mary Symbolis lived there. So Mary Symbolis passed away maybe in 2009, I believe, or 2008. And at that time, the foundation took over the building and had to get it ready for the public, and had to, we replaced the roof. We, the whole inside has been painted, new floor has been put in part of it. And also the furniture, you know, I mean, some of the furniture was there since Krishnamurti was there. So, and they started moving in, I think, in 76. So some of the furniture had to be changed. And I think it looks now really beautiful. If you go into Pine Cottage, we put another fantastic bookshelf up in order to have, when people come. So on one level, of course, you want them to have access to standard Krishnamurti books, Freedom from the Known, First and Last Freedom, Awakening of Intelligence. But there's also, and then also for different languages. You would like, if somebody comes from China or somebody comes from Italy, that you have at least some of the main languages, Arabic, Turkish, Korean, so that some of the main languages you can carry those books, but also you want to have secondary literature, not only literature written by people who express their experiences, but also people who have studied the teachings and somehow documented that. So because we want, when people come to the center, that there's some kind of an exciting amount of books available and that you can read them. And we've gone one step further, that we also are making available, although with restricted access, certain manuscripts, older booklets from before 33, so you can, at request from the librarian, get access to the older collection for those who want to more comprehensively look at Krishnamurti's work, and especially also the older work. I mean, there are some books, and Krishnamurti had really a different style before 33, and it's interesting. If you're a student of the teachings, you might really want to go there. At times, there are jewels amongst that too. And also last but not least is that, so what are we going to do at Pine Cottage? As you've seen, we've moved the May Gathering here. We still have a conference there. We have smaller events there with about 15 people, but we actually don't want to go beyond 40 people at a time at Pine Cottage. So we want to keep the space as a quiet space. We do like to have more students living on campus. At the moment, we have about 11 rooms, but we like to expand that to and add about 12 rooms to it, which could house about 24 students if we want. So we really are hoping to expand, that it becomes like a community where some staff who are living on campus, some students who come there for a year or a little bit longer, and guests are somehow mingling, and in that mingling you get some kind of creative buzz of exploration on the campus. And like, for those who know our campus, we cannot cook. Like here at the school, you can cook, you can make your own meal, but we are not allowed to cook. So we also want to have a place where people can, where we can cook food, provide meals for three times a day for our guests and our staff and our students, and a space where they can mingle and have food together, because we found, and that's more based upon my, because I used to work in Brockwood for almost 9 years, and the meals are actually the time for people to meet new people, because if you're coming to a retreat center, you're coming for breakfast, then you meet some, then you go out, and then if you can't come back, yeah, like here you have to go out to downtown for a meal, but if you can come back for lunch, another point of connection. So that's the way for staff and students and guests to mingle and have, hopefully, explore interesting exchanges. So that's our vision for the place, and we're applying now for permits, and we hope in the coming years to build in a very respectful way. We got all kinds of consultants, historical consultants who have made sure that the historical nature of the place is going to be guaranteed. And in a few years, you will in our e-newsletters, you will see more of this. At the same time, also now, how are we going to use the space? How are we going to use Pine Cottage? As I said, don't want to go over 40, and most of our programs will only have 15, maybe maximal 20 people. But we do want to expand actually our streaming, so that actually more of the things that we're doing are being streamed. So like what's happening now is being streamed. And what we've noticed that in many of our events that we're streaming, there are more people online than they're actually locally present. And streaming is a way for us to really be present in the United States, but even for people in South America. You know, my friends in the Netherlands are also watching part of it. So I know it actually opens us up to show what we're doing and to share what we're doing with a much larger audience. And I feel this is going to grow. That's why we, in Pine Cottage, we have upgraded our technology so we can do that. We can easily do stream better, stream easier, and also be prepared for something what you can call podcasts. So where we maybe have discussions about Kay or about the teachings, and you somehow can podcast that. So that's a different way of format, which we feel will, because podcasting, as you maybe know or maybe don't know, it's a big thing now. I mean, many people don't watch the current news anymore. They go for podcasts. So somehow for us to be there is really important, because that's how people take in new information. It's a new medium, a very important medium. And and these podcasts can be 1.5 hours if you look like Joe Rogan or something. It's like 3 hours long. They're just discussing there. And with like hits, like a million hits, right? I mean, it's not minor. It's like, I don't think we'll be in that category, but even if we can do a fraction of that, that will be really good. So that's our vision. Now, the other part of the vision is just the land, because as you know, care for the teachings and care for the land. Krishnamurti asked both things. And the last couple of months last 2 years, we had several sessions with architects, with planners, and then to find out how we're going. So, what is the best way to lay out for the future? And then on top of that, we had permaculture people, different consultants on irrigation, different consultants on what kind of trees, to make sure that we are becoming a sustainable campus with a minimal amount of water use, because you know drought is in California really a big thing. So minimal amount of water. So we changed from a majority of citrus trees to pomegranates, olives, and jujube trees. So we have really reduced our water footprint. And we built swales to keep the water on the land. So when it rains, normally it all rolls off. So we've done a whole big job of creating swales so the water remains on the land. And I think in the near future, all the new trees will be planted. We already planted 250. We're going to do another 100 in the coming month. And then if you come back in 2 or 3 years, it will be a whole different campus with trees and a whole different setup. I mean, on top of that, you have smaller initiatives like getting more bees on the campus, or there will be bees on the campus. Other initiatives will be like planting a kind of, I don't know if you know, but there's a big issue with the amount of bees everywhere. So, but if you plant the right kind of seeds, spread the right kind of seeds, more insects and bees will benefit from the land. So that's also in the planning, so bees, insects. So that we're somehow a sustainable campus that's going to, somehow also be an example of how you can maintain land and how you can switch from one crop to another crop. I think that's what I had to say. And then I wanted to ask Nasser if he wants to say a few words, because, I mean, what I haven't talked about is that we as foundations, because, for example, you saw a book here that Nasser has been very involved in, the what was that book from Watkins? Yeah, so maybe Nasser can say a little bit more of how that went. And also, the YouTube channel, because the English Foundation is doing a lot of work on the YouTube channel in preparing material and uploading. So it's maybe important if NASA could, would be good if NASA could say a few things about that. And then thirdly, we as foundations, we work very closely together, especially with the English Foundations related to publications. We go to publishers together. We share the contract management. So there's a lot of inter-foundation work happening in order to maximize our resources and have the maximum impact for dissemination. So if NASA is willing to speak, I will put the microphone a little bit lower.
Yes, I would just say a few words. I mean, as Jaap's mentioned, you know, the KFT and KFA work very closely, both for publications and also archive. And a lot of the work that happens, it is the collaboration with this book as well, which is good news. And also the book which was published last year, What Are You Doing With Your Mind? It was also published with Ryder, and it just sold 12,000 copies in about 10 months, mostly to young generations and young audience. And another area is also at KFD, the productions and processes of audios and videos happens, and we put them on both the international website, J. Krishnamurti Online, also on YouTube. And the YouTube has been quite good in terms of disseminations, because YouTube recommends videos to the audience, even if they are browsing about consciousness and watching another person's talking about that. On the right, it may come Krishnamurti, and we have realized 50% of the watches on that platform happens actually through the recommendations by YouTube. And if I remember correctly, in 1 year, I think more than about 6 million times the videos have been watched, and we are putting the videos and with subtitling on this channel. I think there are 2,200 videos subtitled, 600 full length, I think thousands of extracts, and we have put also 400 audios, and we're going to process the rest and put everything online. And these are few things that I think we work in collaborations with KFA, and I thought to touch on that. If there is anything else, you wish me to. All right. Okay. Thank you very much.
So, to any questions, I'm happy to, or we are happy to answer. Yeah, George.
I was not around for it, but I know that the editorial process for the collected work specifically, there was a team that developed a process that the verbatim reports underwent to just basically improve the readability. So yes, there's minimal editing, but there was still editing, and it was laid out as a procedure and followed specifically for each transcript or each verbatim report that's included in the collected works. So the editing project for that body of work was its own specific project. Yeah.
Sometimes the books that are published look almost like a new work when you compare it to the tape.
Yeah, I mean, even with some of the most popular books like Freedom from the Known, that book is far less than a full talk. It's excerpts from many, many different talks.
So, right.
Follow
the sentences, that there's a lot of change.
Yeah, in some cases we go back, like with The Ending of Time, I don't know if you've noticed, but there was an old edition that had quite a few omissions, and now there's a new edition, which it's now almost complete with all the details in it. So different editors also have different processes and different priorities, and that's it. Yeah, Amit. Yeah, correct, yeah.
Is that probably you're also going to say the water and the bees and all that on this campus here? Or?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Okay, and one final quick thing, you said that every foundation all across the world has its own emphasis. Can you say a few lines on what you think of the emphasis around, say, Rockwood and then, you know, say India as well, and there, what are the differences?
Well, I like the Indian Foundation, of course, they have 24 languages, right? I mean, to manage all the translations in 24 languages, I mean, that's like a whole continent, right, of language. So that's a main undertaking. The English Foundation does a lot of work on content, like the digitization and content preparation. So that's more the central hub for processing the digitized material. And the American Foundation, I mean, has been much more active with social media and with new forms of publishing things. It's a more, yeah, traditionally, it's actually interesting because I started in England. And in general, we were very, very conservative, right? I mean, the English Foundation is much more, I mean, I don't want to insult, but much more conservative feeling of it. And the American Foundation is always known as being a little bit frivolous, right? Taking risks and trying things and... And keeps ongoing discussions where the American Foundation goes a little bit too far, you know, like the first website, I mean, that was the American Foundation, or the first Facebook page, you know, and then it's being frowned upon. But then, the JKO was also an American foundation took that initiative, but now it's becoming now the most important thing. It's like, yeah. So, and the next thing we're going to do after this is put Krishnamurti on Alexa. So, no, I was just joking. But I mean, it's not even completely joking, but yeah. but then the important question, and the KFA, we are very much in favor of expanding the collected works into a complete teachings in publishing. But there's within the foundations, we haven't found consensus yet on that. And so we are ready to do 68, 69, let me put it that way. And we hope that one day we were able to do that. Yeah. Yeah, good. What about the bees? Oh yeah, bees, yeah. Of course, there are already bees here. I don't know if you saw, there's a whole tree trunk with bees and then several tree nests in the campus here. But you have to imagine that this piece of land where the school is on is part of a much larger piece of land. Like everything across the hill is all owned by the KFA. And that land is now being, the vision for that land is now being developed on how to maintain it and how to preserve it. Because we have got an alliance with the OI Land Conservancy so that they maintain the paths and so people can walk on it. So it's a beautiful land that you can walk on. So it's now somehow connected with other pieces of land of the OI Conservancy, so people can walk from the one part of OI almost all the way all across. But then the forest maintenance is something that we had a terrible drought. I mean, this year was the first time we had rain. And if you go up the hill, it's called the saddle. The trees have really been suffering, especially high on top, the trees have been suffering badly. But it's coming back. I mean, lots of new trees are coming up. Yeah. But that whole thing about water management, make sure that water remains on the land, that there are trees that are drought tolerant, vegetation that's drought tolerant, and that we make sure that our land, our places where insects, bees, and so can be, it's a very important. I mean, all the foundation members feel that's a really important thing for us to do. Yeah. Trupti.
I just wanted to ask you if you've had any thoughts about having this event, like our events, our live events, translated into Spanish as ongoing. In other words, people who speak Spanish can come here and participate in this event or any other event by, I don't know how you do it, microphones and speakers and a translator, so we can include some of the Spanish population.
Well, you know, I think that's really a good question. I think because Spanish, of course, is becoming a very important language in the United States, and we might have to come to a point where that is necessary, that or we simultaneously translate, or we have some Spanish speaker, that there will be a mix, maybe one or two talks that are just completely in Spanish. Because like Javier is doing his talk in English now, but he could give his talk in Spanish. And there are other people, like we have other people in the foundation who speak fluent Spanish, who could do their work in Spanish. That might actually be, so actually thank you for saying that, because that's a very important direction, I think, for the foundations to actually focus and do much more for the Spanish-speaking language, yeah.
Part of our work to include.
Yeah.
And I was wondering, between 14 and 18-year-olds, to have an ongoing time for dialogue, you know, may not be as intensive as you have it for adults, but is that possible to make that available through the KFA? Because it's not just Oak Grove School, right?
Yeah.
Whoever is interested could come, and the schools could be invited separately even.
Yeah, I would love that. And I think we're all, I mean, at the moment it's manpower and following through, because just to start organizing that is, we need to have time available. But I feel that it would really be good, not only for the Valley, but then also develop material that we somehow can distribute to other schools outside of our region. And we started on that a couple of years ago with Amanda, the program called Think on These Things, where we had a booklet on dialogues. And I think we have paused that for a while because it was just not enough resources to pull that all. But I think that would be my dream, that schools would just come for the day or for a morning and come, and that we have enough people to do dialogue with them and to engage somehow with them on life questions, yeah, deeper questions, yeah.
And you have lots of teachers here who can help.
Yeah. Yeah, but the teachers,
I mean,
you know.
If they get paid, that is.
Yeah, if you work on a school and you know, it is very, very demanding. You need separate people actually who would pull that off. There might be former teachers or something, but you need a group who's dedicated to that. Yeah, but I love that vision actually. It's a really relevant one. Yeah. Yeah. Are we good? Then I wish you a wonderful, see you next year. And thank you all. Thank you also to people who are streaming. And this is the closing of the gathering. I think the dialogue is still going on the other side, but as far as this space, we're going to close. Thank you.